clearly you're a very popular celebrity here, Professor Shoji Shiba. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am delighted to have the honor of yet again welcoming Professor Shoji Shiba on this campus. He's been with us now since yesterday afternoon, and we have been making every use of the opportunity of sharing his and the visit of his delegation with as many of you as possible, with the community at the Indian School of Business, with the community in the Tri-City area, with the students, faculty members and staff of the Indian School of Business. After all, when you have someone of his stature and intellect in your midst, you do want to take advantage of every minute that he chooses to spend with you. So good evening and welcome once again, Shiba-san and your delegation. As I had occasion to mention last night, Professor Shoji Shiba is practically an honorary citizen of India. He appears to have decided many, many years ago to devote a lot of his life and time to this country and its development. For the last 13 years, he has practically lived in the country, spending most of his time here. But his love affair with the nation goes back much longer. Almost 50 years ago when he came here for the first time on a cross-cultural study program. And since then, his devotion and dedication to helping us and the manufacturing sector in particular in India has only increased. He is fondly called the God of Manufacturing. He also has many other titles of a similar nature. He is indeed the father figure of total quality management and breakthrough management, a concept that he himself has devised and propagated. Since 2006 in particular, in collaboration with the CII and with Sarita Nagpal, who is a member of his delegation today, he founded what is known as the VLFM, the Visionary Leaders for Manufacturing Program, a program that has gone from strength to strength in the 10 years of its existence since then. The delivery of this program in the manufacturing sector is now domiciled in three institutions of this nation, three esteemed, well-known institutions of this country, the IIT Kanpur, IIT Madras at Chennai, and IIM Kolkata. That program, of course, continues to be supported by JICA. Dr. Shiba's delegation has five other members, Mr. Kotaro Tanaka, who is sitting in front of me on my right, is the Divisional Director of the South Asia Division of JICA. He comes to us from Tokyo this time. However, he has lived in India earlier from 2000 to 2003 as part of the JICA India operations here. Also along with him is Professor Piyush Mehta from IIT, IIM Kolkata now, earlier from IIT Kanpur. Dr. Rahul Marathe from IIT Madras. And Mr. Raman. Right, he likes to be called GR, and he advised me to make it simple, but I thought I'll be more exotic, Mr. Sundaraman from the Godrej Group of Industries, a man who truly bridges industry and academia. His roots are in industry. He is very much a corporate citizen in marketing and operations and logistics, but he also has very deep associations with the world of academia and has been associated with the Cambridge University as well as Harvard and MIT. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, Sarita Nagpal, who is currently senior advisor with CII, having been associated with CII for more than 27 years. Professor Shoji Shiba will address us this evening on the topic, My Experience from Indian Fishbowl, a Decade of Visionary Leaders for Manufacturing. Joining us today are also a similar group of students and faculty members and staff members in our Hyderabad campus over a video conference. And at the end of the address, there will be a Q&A session which will be moderated by Dean Raj Srivastav. The questions will also come from Hyderabad, so please bear with us as we manage those logistics challenges as well. With these few words, may I now invite Dean Raj Srivastav to say a few words. Thank you.
Professor Shiba, thank you for gracing this occasion. Pradeep has already said it all. You know, we're very grateful to the entire delegation. This is an important event for us. ISB is very, very fortunate to have access to thought leaders, and the Dean Speaker Series is really our small attempt to share the wealth of knowledge that we have access to, you know, with the community. So I would also like to welcome people here who are from outside our, you know, four walls of ISB. And if we look at Professor Shiba's investment in India, it's not just India. On issues related to total quality management, he's been thought of around the world on four continents, and he's been really dedicated to the practice of total quality management. He has managed to put together this Visionary Leaders Program, and I'll echo that. You know, India has two great brands, IIT and IIM. Very rarely have those two brands worked together. I'm being honest. I was hosting a directors meeting in Singapore about 3 years ago. There were IIT directors, there were IIM directors. And it took the president of a university called Singapore University for Technology and Design, who was on loan from MIT, to make the statement, you know, why don't, you know, great Indian institutions get together? So, sir, thank you for bringing with you our colleagues from IIT and IIM. And we would like to add to that list a third great Indian institution called the Indian School of Business. So, if you recall, back in January, we laid out three criteria that ISB must deliver on. The criteria were balance on theory and practice. The criteria included a balance between East and West. And the third element was to have impact on both business practice as well as government policy. Professor Shiba embodies all three elements. If you look at his impact, it's been around the world. It's been the integration of theory and practice, and it certainly has been combining ideas and implementing those ideas around the world. So we could have not asked for any better individual who could embody our aspirations. So for that, we're really grateful. And rather than stand in the way, I would like you guys to do is to keep your pencils handy. We will have an interactive session at the end of the presentation. And I look forward to your questions, to an exciting, you know, post-presentation session. So thank you, Professor Shiba, for gracing us, and may I invite you to.
Okay. My journey started in the July 25, 2004, when I met Dr. Abdul Kalam, your president, former president. I came to India just before this time. Then, after my session end, I was introduced to Dr. Kalam in his office. I was really surprised. No notice before. I was just brought to the office with Sarita Nangpal. Okay. Then we discuss. He asked me to support development of Indian manufacturing. He said there are three types of companies in India. Those, okay, what happens? This is first one. This one is those company has R&D capability and they can make print themselves and develop themselves. But those company are only small number. Majority of company is just gets some prints, then develop, just make it. So he said to me, how can this third group to better to number two? Then this come to the number one. How to do it? I said, it is impossible for me to do it. Shoji Shiba is only one. So many big number of these groups. Then what I can do is only one thing, to create a locomotive to pull the Indian manufacturing industries. This is coming from my experience in Japan. When we started from zero after the Second World War II, then we have nothing, no industry, no house, no food. Then we had Sony, Toyota, Honda. Those great company play the role of locomotive to pull the Japanese industry. Without Sony, without Toyota, without Honda, no Japanese development happened. In the same way, I can make the Sony of India, Sony of Honda of India. That's what I can do. This is a discussion we spend, Sarita, maybe more than 1 hour, 1.5 hour with him in his office. This is my commitment. Without this commitment, I do not work such a long time in India. Then I determined to mine to start learning community. Okay. Started from 2004. Then within 2 years, I proved real success in 14 companies. Without success, no one believe what I said. After my success, it was 2006. our program become national program. NMCC, Dr. Krishnamurthy, okay, asked support our program to make a national program. And in addition, this is breakthrough in a collaboration between IIM and IITs. That's a wonderful breakthrough. And this program started within 1 year, started from 2007. This also my surprise, breakthrough India. Currently, we have a four program, five, of course, CEO's program, then senior manager's program, middle manager's program, young people, and SME. In addition, we started Village Buddha Project, which creates a leader for village development. Village is changing in India very much. And village is a new market, emerging market for manufacturing company. There are great possible opportunity in the village development. Therefore, we started this five program, then running. When we start this program, I have my motive, transform engineers into visionary leaders. The reason is lesson learned at my learning at MIT. When I worked at MIT, I learned breakthrough is important. Without breakthrough, no future of the manufacturing. How to create a breakthrough? Not only technology, not only management. Combine technology and management, then breakthrough will happen. This is my lesson learned at the United States and at MIT. Only technology cannot make breakthrough. It needs to combine with business breakthrough. Therefore, I try to unite engineering and management. I focus to breakthrough. GS just come to stand in here to show that your background. This is our uniform. You see, son? Okay, this is, I'm a Buddhist. Okay? So I always pray the Buddha. Buddha has three eyes. This eye is breakthrough. This eye is a control, eye of the past. And this eye is an incremental improvement. Manufacturing needs three eyes, especially this breakthrough eyes. Therefore, engineering and technology and management must unite. This is my concept. Thank you, GS. And also, I have a three basic approach to design the program. Number one, skill-based. Okay. Second, unite learning and doing. We need the impact, results, immediately. Last one is a new manufacturing concept. Just I quickly explain these three, my basic approach. Number one is a skill-based learning process. There are three types of learning process. Number one is lecture style. Okay? Great teacher, talk. many people take note or sleep. That's the first type. Second type is a dialogue, like a Harvard case study. Ask the question, okay? Then answer, then and again. Not ask, come back, then ask once more. This is a dialogue style. These both are good. Both are good. But I want to, Shoji Shiba, want to jump into fishbowl style of teaching. This is my expertise. What is a fishbowl approach? Again, this comes from my experience, great experience at MIT. Shoji Shiba had his first lecture at MIT in 1990. About I was asked to talk about the TQAM to the graduate student. But many professors attended my class, just the same as today. Then at the end of my lecture, one professor just sitting exactly in front of me. He asked me, don't ask the question about my TQM. He asked me, what is your unique approach to problem solving? Then I was surprised and really surprised, oh, this is MIT. Then I keep silent for 30 seconds. Still I remember. Then I draw the because even now I'm not so fluent in English, but on that time I couldn't speak so good English. Only way I can show is sketch. Here is a fish bowl, there is a fish. I want to know what the fish is and how the fish think about. Okay. Then there are two ways to understand the fish. One methodology is create objective scale. And researcher stand outside of the fish bowl. Then observe the movement of fish by logic. This is very good, very scientific methodology, objective and logic. But Shoji Shiba don't follow this methodology because this is a hypothesis. Shoji Shiba want to create a hypothesis, not to prove the hypothesis. How to do it? Here is a Shoji Shiba. Okay. Then I take out jackets, shirts, only small shorts here. Then jump into fish bowl. Then swim with a fish. Okay. But sometimes these are not a fish, maybe piranha. But don't afraid. Just jump into fish bowl. Swim with a fish. Then after swimming, jump out. Then think about what the fish is by intuition. This is Shoji Shiba's way. I never thought until I draw this diagram. Such a great question inspired me. Then after I wrote and explained here, all the professor, most of the professor give me a big hand. I was so impressed that MIT is quite open. Nobody knows Shoji Shiba is. But if it's meaningful, all the MIT professors gave me a hand. I was so impressed and I committed to work at MIT. Okay. Then this is a, then no, MIT gave me another privilege. This is a cover page of Sloan School of Management. Sloan School of Management kindly gave me my photo in the front page and described Shoji Shiba's this one. Okay. Thank you very much. This is my pleasure. Okay. Cover page. Then I can stay at MIT for 15 years. Many professors at MIT, like Eric von Hippel, started his journey from this fishbowl concept. I'm very honored and happy. Then this kind of fishbowl concept creates skill. What is a skill? Skill is the only source to get the results. I think first learning is to get the knowledge. You can get the knowledge from information plus commentary. Does this give the knowledge, give the results? No. Okay. Then next step is understanding. Understanding starts from knowledge. Plus, apply to your job. Then you have a question. Knowledge is in general. Your problem is, your job is specific. Therefore, there is a gap. Then you have an opportunity to ask the question. But still, this doesn't give the results. Next one is a skill. Skill is your behavior. Behavior comes from understanding. Plus repetition. Repeat. Then it becomes a habit. Then your behavior creates a result. Therefore, I focus to skill in order to create a result. This is my belief, skill-based learning process. Then second is unite learning and doing. Again, this is a source of results. We create a result. Without the result, I cannot improve the Indian manufacturing. My objective is to develop the Indian manufacturing. Therefore, it is necessary to get the result. Usually, give the teaching outside of Gemba, then learn, apply, reflect, okay? Go to Gemba, then come back. It takes time. It is necessary to unite Gemba and learning. How to do it? Learn skill, basic skill. At classroom, then apply immediately to on Gemba, on site. Then conceptualize and next application. Run this cycle quickly. Then you have a skill. We create this kind of system. This is unite learning and doing. Last one is new manufacturing concept. When I started the project 2004 in the India, most of the manufacturing people think that production is manufacturing. But I said no. Before the production, design, before and adding, after the production, sales, warranty, etc. Also, there is a supply chain. Also, technology change, government regulation, manufacturing change, etc. All these are manufacturing. We call this one small manufacturing to big manufacturing. This is not only India. When I went in the USA in 1990s, US people also had the same thing. Manufacturing is a production. But in the US, within 10 years, they changed to the BQM concept. This is a new manufacturing concept. Because maybe some of you already know the T. Fujimoto's concept of manufacturing. Product as a design information. Design information embedded to the medium. Okay. This is a innovative new manufacturing concept. Therefore, product development, product planning, this is a key part, not production process. Right now, Toyota says 95% of the value added comes from this side, product design, product planning. This part is only 5% value added. The manufacturing people must focus this area. This area is concept creation. Okay. Skill. You need a skill to create a concept. Therefore, we created conceptual skill by five-step discovery process. This is a new methodology. Manufacturing is not to make the manual skill, rather than create a conceptual skill to create a new product, new design. This is my motif. Now, let me show the uniqueness of our program. There are four programs, but focus to first senior manager's course. Okay. GS, please come and to show the uniqueness.
So yes, as Professor Shoji Shiba said, the whole foundation of learning begins with the mindset. If your eyes are not open, you can't see. But if your mind is closed, even if your eyes are open, you cannot see. So the starting point is to get the mindset. And so therefore we start with the mindsets and the basic skills. But our classroom is not the class. Our classroom is the reality. So the very first module people would want to know how to do observations and how to make the explorations. The class is in the shop floor, and most of the time we are very close to Godrej, or we are close to Mahindras, or we are close to Crompton and Graves. So they start their class in the shop floor. The objective is not to say what production system is there, what flow system is there. The objective is to say, see what is happening and conceptualize as to what is the model that is operating. Because there isn't any particular model that a particular organization will see. It's a Godrej model, it's a Mahindra model, it's a Crompton Greaves fan factory model, and that is how they begin to conceptualize from the reality. For example, our module 3, which is the exploration of the latent needs, we call it as the vertical exploration. That module of product development and product conceptualization begins with the customer's house or in the marketplace, because that is where the new ideas really come. And therefore, that is the way that we create the second skill. The third part is that the skills are not in pieces, but they are integrated together. So unless you integrate from its concepts and philosophy to the mission and right up to the execution, you cannot get the results, you cannot really implement it. Traditionally, I was led to believe that strategizing is the people up into the higher hierarchies and execution is left to the people. If the strategist cannot execute, the execution cannot happen with the people on the shop floor and ship people who are on the field. And in my very, very first lessons from Professor Shoji Shiba, when I gave that this is what the strategy looks like, his question was, GS, can you implement it? GS, can you do this yourself? GS, can you see it yourself? If you can't do it, then it's very likely that others can't do it. And that is the part of the leadership that we develop into this program. And the last part of the way that we make our program very unique is that there is no teaching and there is no learning. Professor Shiba doesn't believe in it. The only way you can transfer this learning is by demonstrating. I don't tell you what to do, I show you how to do it. I don't criticize that this is right, this is wrong. I help you to make your things better. So where are our cases? We are not cases in the Harvard. We don't take all of those cases. Our case is the practical application that the person has made in the class. So there are 10 groups in the class. There are 10 cases which are live, and they are able to create those ones. Those are the examples. Some are right, some are not right, some need improvement. And you show this to the class to say, this is how you improve. And show to the class, say, this is the best example of how you could turn. That is the way that we do. Put all this together, you get a very systematic, holistic development of people, not piece by piece part of the development. And that is the uniqueness of the VLFM program, right from the philosophy right to the execution. And that, in a nutshell, is what we really been working with Professor Shiba. And I would like to admit out here that if it wasn't for Professor Shiba, a lot of these things, I would never have been able to do it. 10 years of my life with Professor Shiba changed 35 years of my life that I had post my MBA from IIM Ahmedabad. I really couldn't see. I couldn't have my eyes open. It is with this that we could open. And that's hopefully helping a few more people to open their eyes. That's the uniqueness of our program. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is the uniqueness of collaboration IIT IIM. Piyush?
So as Dean pointed earlier that why don't these institutes talk and why don't they do something together? So it was really a monumental task to have this breakthrough. So another variant of the VLFM program is this is called Opportunity B, where these three institutes with very different mindsets. So it's not just one elephant in the room, there are three elephants in the room, to bring them together, to have different perspectives and one common agenda. So this was a real breakthrough achieved 10 years back when this whole initiative was started. So these three institutes, it's a unique program in the country because it's one of a kind that there's a technology input in this program and then there's a management input from IIM. So two IITs and one IIM, they got together and then they created this program. It's a 1 year residential program where only the engineers with minimum experience in manufacturing are taken.
Okay.
So this is a unique part. The second uniqueness comes from the way the whole experience is transferred to the students. So as you can see, the geography of these three institutes allows them to experience different cultures. So they start from IIM Calcutta, then they go to IIT Kanpur for their coursework, from there to go to IIT Madras. So they are able to see different perspectives, they are able to feel, experience different cultures. At the end of the coursework, they go to Japan with an objective of understanding and learning from the society of Japan, the way the forms have developed, and doing some cross-cultural research. So that's the kind of diversity of cultural exposure they get in this program. The objective of the Japan visit is the uniqueness, the third uniqueness of this program comes from the Japan visit, where it's a different model of leadership, which is a very proactive way of looking at the whole issue of how do you embed leadership in these participants. So this is one of the things they do, which is called self-initiated research. They do a lot of homework before they go to Japan for this. And this kind of issue is based on either a society-based, community-based, or any kind of relevant issue to the society. So this is just one instance, just a couple of examples of what is this self-initiated research. The idea is to understand, observe, do some data analysis, gather data, do data analysis, and then present the results. It is completely open-ended thing. It's a proactive way of looking at the whole issue. So these are some of the examples of self-initiated research. So I think together these three dimensions add a lot of robustness to the program, and it was a monumental task. As it stood, it has been 10 years, so that adds to the sustainability of the program. Thank you.
Okay. Next one, just to explain how they go to on-site.
Yeah, so this is the process of this self-initiated research. As I said, this comprises observations and then data collection and then analyzing the data. So this is after their observation, they are analyzing the whole their survey, their whatever data they have collected, and then this is being summarized. The research is presented in this format, which comprises the strengths, the weaknesses, and what was the result of this whole analysis.
Okay, thank you. Then last one is a uniqueness of VSME activities. This is one of the most successful program in our program.
So the most successful program under the VLFM in terms of the impact, the business results that we are able to see are happening in the large companies who have a clear structured supplier base. So primarily you know that for those of you who've been working with supply chains, you know that typical relationship between the OEM and the tier ones, and likewise between the tier one and tier twos, the relationships are normally of mistrust, because always there is a kind of a competitive pressure, there is negotiation, they're looking at, you know, if there is a benefit, then how much price benefits, who can get more advantage. Whereas the 1000 VSME program has completely turned around this concept. So through again a systematic approach, which has been introduced by Professor Shiba and Mr. Furuhashi. So there is another expert involved in this exercise. So this follows a process of again mutual learning. So the OEM and the tier one learn together. Similarly, the tier one and tier two learn together. That is mutual learning. And how does this happen? It happens through what we call as a model line concept. So we start with the OEM, we start with the line which is delivering to the market. And we start from there, we implement the program on the model line with the customer. And then the customer goes to the supplier to demonstrate how to really implement it. So this is really done as a partnership, and therefore the result is a win-win relationship, which is a very different to what is the traditional practice. This has led to both profitability and productivity improvement for both the OEM, the tier ones, and the tier twos. So this is the thousand.
Okay, just I want to more explain model line concept. This comes from my experience, snowball concept. When you want to create some results, okay, there is a secret. You need to success at the beginning. If you don't success at the beginning, never happens reality, results. Therefore, intentionally, strategically create a success, even small, make success. Okay? Then next success happens. Then next success comes, third success comes. Therefore, first success is a key to get the results. We call snowball concept.
Just to build on that, when we started this program, it was really experimented in one of the tier one companies who's part of the VLFM community. And once they experimented and were able to establish that it works, we slowly extended it to the tier ones and the tier twos. And this year, we had a breakthrough and we've gone to the OEM. So now we are actually working with a very large Indian manufacturer in the automotive space, where in one of their main businesses across five of their plants, we've been able to implement this whole supplier relationship transformation program.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay. Now come to the end. My dream. To develop many, many smart creators. What smart creators? Currently, market wants not only quality products, something very new function, surprising, radically useful for users. These are market want this kind of products, not better quality, less cost, more durability, etc. Those age passed in the manufacturing. So we call this one key characteristic of we need to create a smart creator for innovation. Okay. So one key characteristic is multiple viewpoint, not a single viewpoint. Marketing, finance, and product engineering. Needs a different multiple viewpoint is necessary. And also super self-initiative. Therefore, we work as self-initiative research work. People need to work their own way, initiate themselves. And also power to involve others, not work alone. And overworked in a good way. Many people think about work-life balance. It's okay in the long term, but when you make something great breakthrough, need don't separate work and private life. You must unite. You see, those people coming here, MBA candidate, do you have a work-life balance? You are working, study. This is what I say here. Overworked in good way. Then you can make the smart creator. I want to create more and more such a people in India. So far, we create such a people. I cannot see such a great eyesight in Japan. Such a wonderful Indian geniuses. And even young people, future smart creator is going to create. This is I want to make more and more such a people in India. This is my dream. Thank you very much. At the end, I want to present our some of the books and achievement to deans. Okay, so this is a book for our success stories. Thank you. And also, these are our process. These are the leaders. And this is the our history. We got the JICA Presidential Award. Then we make a history, okay, of our program. And one more. This is a, we so big. This is a success story of Tata, Tata Motor, commercial vehicle. Okay? They implement VSME approach from OEM Tier 1, Tier 2. They published this one very recently. This is a success story. This is the real results to the industry. I'm very happy to present new one to you. Thank you very much.
So this was really, really, really inspiring. And I would like to change a definition of leadership that I had been thinking of. And a very visionary person taught me that if you were a leader and if you turned around and nobody was following you, you were going for a walk. So that was my earlier definition. Today, what I have learned in these last 45 minutes, that a real leader brings people along with him or her. So may I please invite the entire team to come up on stage. Pradeep, we would love to have a photograph, you know, with a leader. Before we take questions from the audience, I have a couple of questions. But one of the things that I noted as I was trying to take notes very furiously, and I've got two pages of notes in very small print, so I've personally learned a lot here. I think, Professor, we need to get hold of you every year, and I need to make sure that all our faculty learn from this. So this is learning, to me, the whole exercise was learning by storytelling, and storytelling by a team. So tremendous, tremendous way to learn. So a couple of questions I had for you, sir. So what you talked about by jumping into a fishbowl, is until you swim with the fish, you don't understand the conditions under which the fish are swimming. So the hypothesis, the theory, has to be informed by the environment, by the practice. So one of the things I learned from you is that before you can understand how to do things, you have to actually try to do them.
Yes, exactly.
So what led you to that? So before you told the MIT professors the fishbowl, you must have gone through some learning journey which made you realize that you need to jump into the fishbowl. What was that?
Yes, my life is always jumping into fishbowl. But I didn't realize it at all after I was asked such a question. Mm-hmm. In the first, I jumped into Japanese public utilities, 40,000 employees. Then I swimmed with. Then next I jump into Hungary. Then I swim it. After swimming, I get some learning. Swimming is a learning. Learning is contribute to the company, contribute to the Hungary. So jumping to fishbowl is a learning process. No hypothesis is not necessary, but planning, investigation is necessary. Then forget such a logic. Just open your intuition. Intuition has a brain. We can see invisible by intuition. Any quick answer?
I think the audience should feel open to respond as well. So it's not just me and the professor. You put two professors together and we'll keep talking all night. Any observations from the audience on this? Your experiences perhaps? All right, I will not do any cold calling for the moment. I will go to my...
Any question? Okay, yeah. Please. Thank you.
So I worked around 3 years in a Japanese company in the production department, and I'm not an engineer. I worked there for 3 years, and believe me, I was able to solve some of the issues which were lying there for 10 years. No engineer was able to solve that. When I saw this VLM program and everything, it's changing an engineer into a visionary leader. If I want to change myself into a leader, why I need an engineering degree? So my simple question is that if I want to bring some change, then why engineering degree is necessary? Because I don't have it. So there are a lot of people in manufacturing department who are not engineers, but still they are doing great. So how you think in future this VLM program can help them?
Well, I agree there are many geniuses. Hey? Even those have no engineering degree, they can learn engineering by themselves. That's a genius. But most of engineers, from my viewpoint in India, they are narrow-minded, okay? Small M mentality, engineering mentality. Need to break such an engineering mentality into big M mentality. That is my job. Then, if they have the engineering technology, there are more possibility to make a breakthrough, technical breakthrough. But technical breakthrough is not enough. Management breakthrough is necessary to combine with technical breakthrough. This is my job. Okay? So there are many, many geniuses, but my focus is convert engineering people to more broader, make more breakthrough.
Okay. All of you know Mr. Adi Godrej, and I'm sure that I don't have to introduce that. But Adi's uncle is Jamshed's father, late N.P. Godrej. N.P. Godrej was not an engineer. He has created the entire Vikhroli and all the 19 plants of manufacturing of the high quality engineering that what Godrej is reputed to be.
not only that he created the engineering, he created the vision of the Pirotshanagar, he executed it, and by the way, he taught me what is engineering, because after 10 years of IIT when I started working with him, he just said that, oh, you're from engineering. I said, yes. So, and I actually was very proud, and I thought that I knew everything. He just gave me one tool and said, GS, can you find out where is this tool used? Till date, I have not found out where it is used.
Also, Professor said it's learning by doing. So if you're not an engineer, do engineering and you'll learn.
Yes, exactly. Very good.
So we have a question from, we had a question from Hyderabad till the,
okay, very good.
Till this instrument died on me. Chitti, you? Okay, I think I remember what the question was, and this is maybe not a fair question, and I think I should address it to the whole team. You've been at ISB for all of one day, and the question coming from Hyderabad was, what is one piece of advice you would give to ISB based on what you have learnt about us so far?
Very good question. Okay? Very good question. Okay? Don't think one. That is my answer. Okay? Don't think only one. Always think three. Three. Why the three?
This is my answer to you. You have to advise. My advice is to see the reality 360 degrees. Okay? This is the essence of the MBA, to see the reality from different viewpoints. Am I right? That's a 360. How to make 360? Just to see the 360 is not a skill. Just a motto. Skill is like this. Always think three. This is X, Y, G. This is a shorthand of 360 degree. Each axis must be independent. Three is always think three answers. Three solutions, three questions. Okay? All elements must be orthogonal, independent. Then, if you ask the questions, I have a three questions, I have a three ideas. Okay? If I summarize, I can summarize three. All three. This is a 360 degree view. Use three. This is orthogonal. Okay? Three different axes. Practice every day, every hours. If comes some idea, this is not one. Maybe another two, another three. Okay? Three, every hour you practice, practice, think three. X, Y, G. Okay? This is a skill for you to get a 360 degree view. Then you will get good results. That's my answer to you. Thank you very much. Wonderful question.
So I have one question, and I want you to think of the next one. You talked about making tier 2, tier 1, OEM, look at the value chain, the supply chain. And the issue is, how do we make two or more organizations work in the same direction? You also succeeded IIT, making IIT and IIM working together. So in getting organizations with slightly different objectives, what is the how can you get them unified and marching in the same direction?
Okay, I show three answers, marching, okay, X, Y, Z. Number one, clear objective. Clear objective to share tier 1 OEM, tier 1, tier 2. This is number one. Then all the mindset of tier 1, tier 2 top management people must say, this is starting from mindset change. Mindset must be said. That is number one. Objective is not enough. Mindset become, sorry. Then next one, if you harmonize or collaborate organization, organization is not bottom up, top to down. Three, may set the objective clearly, it makes them to the mindset change. Then follow the top-down cascading system. In the case of IIT, IIM collaboration, comes from director, don't you? And also they have the common mindset. Then it happens. Jesus 3.
So this is clearly the kind of thinking we need when we start talking about designing the entire value chain. So we're not talking about designing a product. We're designing everything from component to the customer. So this is very instructive. Getting the mind together, getting the objectives together, and driving it from the top so to get the organizational commitment. So let's
many people misunderstand. If we create objective, it become common. It's not true. Objective is here. I don't know where is the mind. Mind must be set. Therefore, I said the mindset change is critical.
My name is Manish Trehan. I am the CEO of PTU Nalanda School of Product Quality Management in Mohali. It was a very, very inspiring session, Professor Shiba. I have two related questions. One, which company globally do you, whose manufacturing practices do you admire the most and why? And in India, which company do you admire the most for manufacturing practices?
Please don't think in such a way. Okay? Each company has a uniqueness. Don't make rank. Okay? I don't like the hierarchical number one, number two, number three, number four. It's not the reality. Even in any company has a good point. Find out a good point. Learn from the good point. I come here to learn ISB. I learned so much in these 2 days. I never think which is better, VLFM better, ISB better. Never think like this. Just think, oh, what is good to this ISB? Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Just learn. Forget about ranking, or forget about which is better, best, which one is the second. Change your mindset. Then there is a many opportunity to learn, make you better. I think for me, I want to learn more. I want to make better India. That is only my objective, not imitate best one, rather than learn from each company, even some company has a mistake. Learn from mistake. Learn from strength. This mindset is my mindset. Therefore, unfortunately, I cannot answer your question.
So, questions? Yes.
Good evening, Professor. You were talking about the applications of VLFM in the corporate scenario. And India is nowadays concentrating a lot of the cities. You have the concept of smart cities coming up. Does VLFM have any application in changing the village landscape as well of India? Like what has VLFM already done or can be done to change the way things are happening in our villages?
That's a good question. But unfortunately, I'm not so good in the village or Indian society. Maybe can you answer?
Okay. 1 minute.
Yes, please. Okay, this related to more culture, okay, societal culture. I'm not so much good to understand culture. Okay. So maybe GS?
Yeah. I mean, long question and long answer, so I'll just summarize in three things. The best way to apply the VLFM learning to the village is fishbowl. I think learning about or talking about village from outside and said that has got a... In the last 3 to 4 years with Professor Shiba, I have traveled to many villages and we have done the same fishbowl in village and walked around, stayed, lived there, and I think that the first application of VLFM in the village is be in the village with the villagers to understand what village is. Otherwise, you cannot understand what village is. You cannot read a report about the village. You need to be living and you need to go through. So we have lived there. We have eaten things there. We have walked around in the market and then taken things from there. That's how Professor Shri Shiba and I and some of the other colleagues have lived. Number one. Number two, village development is holistic and integrated, what we showed in this program. You don't say that somebody just gives water and somebody just does education and somebody does the healthcare. Village will not improve if you do one piece. Village is a holistic, organic ecosystem and therefore it needs a holistic development. And the last part of what VLFM can get, thinking about village doesn't help. Doing something about it really works. So demonstrate to the villagers what needs to be done, but don't talk about them to say that, you know, you have to have it clean and you have to have it. Demonstrate. And I think the most important demonstration is our own behavior, which is what we need to develop. So if we want to be disciplined, we have to be disciplined. You know, we have to demonstrate that. If we are a community together, we wear the same t-shirts. It's not here in the institute. When we went to Budapest and in that large conference, we were in the same t-shirt. Because we believe that we are a community, we are together. So we have no shame in wearing and things. We believe that that's the way. And I think that's the short answer for what you can do with VLFM in village. Thank you.
Good evening, Professor Shiba. I admired your concept where you spoke about creating strategically success and then snowballs to further successes.
Thank you very much.
So, sir, out of all the successes that you have had in your life, which would you rate as your small created success which really helped you move along?
Sorry?
Sir, you have had a lot of successes in your life, so which was your created strategic success that you would like to say that was the first one which snowballed into further successes?
Sorry, I don't feel any success. Okay?
Right.
Yes, okay. I had a very bitter experience. I felt in the USA, okay, incremental improvement is the best way to improve the company. But Andrew Grove, former CEO of the Intel, told me it is a time to change the business completely, not like this. Okay, I thought this is the best way to improve. But Andrew Grove's books t-
taught me this is same business. Need to change another business, change the business A to B.
I learned from this my failure.
I was so much arrogant, this is only management. But Andrew Grove said, there is new age of new management. I learned, I was arrogant. I thought I was a success, expert and worldwide, incremental improved, grew, etc. Therefore, after this, I forgot to think about success. Even small, I felt success. Then I repeat, success is a first step to failure. Success is a first step failure. Not to think about success at all. This is my motto. Please don't ask me what is your success. No success. Once I feel success, it is my failure. I create my failure. Good question. Thank you very much.
One more from this side, and then I'd like to move, and then I'll come back to you.
Good evening, Professor. My question is related to...
Sorry. Could you stand up? I can want to see your face.
Introduce
yourself. My name is Mayank Srivastava.
Yes.
I worked in PHL manufacturing sector for past 4 years. My question is related to the mutual learning concept in the supply chain management. So in a practical scenario, there's always a competition between sub-suppliers and original equipment manufacturers. So how this concept of mutual learning can really be applied in a practical scenario? Because there's always a possibility of forward integration and backward integration. The original equipment manufacturer can assume the role of supplier and also backward.
Okay, genius.
If the pie is the same size, there is a competitive pressure to take a larger pie. If the pie can become bigger, I think there isn't any competition. I think the pie that we are talking about in India is so big that you are only nibbling at small pieces of that pie. If you are able to give this message to the people in the win-win supply chain, there isn't anything. Second thing, it is the OEM who is creating the competition among the suppliers, because that's the only way that he knew how to manage purchase. I was managing purchase for appliances, and I handled maybe about 600, 700 crores at that time. And I know that the game was you put one supplier against the other. I learned that's a wrong way to do it. The collaboration will automatically happen. That's the short answer to this.
My question is, that our labor force in India is projected to grow by almost 30% over the next 20 years. And our government is trying to get all these millions of people employed in the manufacturing sector over the next few years. So what do you think are the most important things to keep in mind while following this roadmap to improve manufacturing in India?
Okay, very good question. Okay. Sarita maybe have some such an idea.
You said India is growing. Okay. What to do? What do you think? Do we think?
So my question was, since we have so many people to employ, how can we create those many jobs and also create the skills to employ these people in manufacturing?
No, I cannot answer such questions. What I'm doing to change the industry, not to create a job, rather than make more good relation with supplier, etc. And also make more profit, make more better products. So that is a different story. I cannot answer. Can you answer?
Maybe Prime Minister Modi.
Maybe, okay. So this is very, I think this is important, okay. I can do what I can do. I don't to do or answer what I cannot do. Okay? So far, what I present today is what I did. I am very much confident what I spoke. But create a job is I never do before in my life. Therefore, I cannot answer at all. Okay.
We are 10 minutes over time, so this will be the last two questions. And then we can take one more. Yes, sir.
Professor Shiba, my name is Varun. And I've got a question on the VSME model. So when you started off this journey, starting from the OEM and then as you moved to T1 and T2, so typically there might have been the fear among T1 and T2 that this model is done by the OEM to cut cost and to actually make the T1s and T2s more productive so that they can actually pass on the cost benefit to the OEM.
Okay, Sarita.
So how did you manage this challenge?
Yes, that's a very good question.
Transformation?
Very relevant question. We faced this problem. Okay, please.
So the way it works is, you see, typically what has been happening in the past is that the OEM is facing a lot of, the OEMs are facing a lot of competition because increasing number of OEMs are in our country today. So there is huge pressure to introduce new products faster. Number two is to bring down your costs continuously while the traditional systems of forecasting are failing. So that's the crisis in which the OEM is. So what does he do? He puts the pressure onto the tier one supplier. And the tier one supplier has a negotiation at every year's annual conference and comes out with what's the deal. The VSME program completely turned this whole relationship around. What happens is that at the OEM itself, we are looking at, now we know the company I was talking about, Tata Motors. So in their commercial vehicle business, across all 5 plants, they picked up the final assembly line which is supplying to the market. And they said, what's going to be the output for this year? How is it going to break up into this week's production plan? And you come out with what is it that line needs to deliver in order to meet the fluctuating market. But you are going to build up inventory at the OEM. Now the OEM identifies if they have to achieve that target, what are the bottlenecks in their final assembly. From there, they work out in between the internal tier suppliers, because there will be some parts which are being made by the OEM himself and some are being made by the tier one companies. So they identify which of these components, what is the rate at which I need the outputs, so that I am able to synchronize the production to meet the market requirement. And we are going to do that almost on a daily basis. So you break down your production planning to literally a daily basis and work out what is the supply required. Once you work that out, then the OEM on his line makes the improvements. 1 month, they implement themselves. After that, we invite the suppliers from the tier one, come now and see what we have done. Would you now trust us to come to your plant and help you to implement? So the same training and process is implemented first in the OEM, then it goes to the tier one. So when we implement in the tier one and they realize that when the customer said I needed 100, they were quite happy if I gave them 95, quite happy if I gave them sometimes 110, So there wasn't even that, any fixed numbers that were being agreed to and were being delivered. But now with this Hyjunka system, it is what is called as the push-pull system, the Hyjunka system, through this we are creating this synchronization between the OEM and the tier 1 for a particular product line. So it's been implemented in Tata Motors, for instance, in their model line. And that's a success story book we've given. So those 14 success stories are from Tata Motors and their suppliers. So each one of them was able to, you know, get the at least 600% improvement. I mean, the maximum is about 600%, and the minimum is 125% improvement in productivity. So both have, you know, benefited. So the OEM has also improved their output, and Tier 1 has also improved, and Tier 2 has also improved. So when all are winning, then there will definitely be a trust. But it's only when one is a win and one is a lose that there becomes a distrust. So that's what the VSME system has able to, you know, it has been able to overcome. So it's again using, as we demonstrated, that it's through a go and demonstrate principle. First, the OEM is making the change, which the tier one companies are so surprised. Tata's making a change. It is something
again,
not
the issue of the mindset change. Okay? So first creates a such a mindset change completely from the top management.
Okay.
Last question.
I am PSNL. I have a manufacturing company. So my question is that for a breakthrough from small end to big end, this small end should have some size in terms of resources, or anybody can do from small end to big end.
Yes. Yes, all people must do it. Otherwise, you cannot survive. Right?
There's no limit that minimum size should be this one.
No. Right? Good example is a Japanese small and medium size. They have a expertise. And they create own own concept. For example, different expertise of small and medium size of company united together, then create something new. Okay. So you think you are thinking like this? We are very small like this.
We are here. There are big. We are here. Therefore, we are small M. This kind of those companies can make us big M. But
big M and small M is not a size. The broadness of your mindset. If you just think about my job is only production, you are still, you cannot get out from small M. Okay? Even my part is here, but how can we include other element, societal change? Any changes, and think about what I can do. Please open your horizon. Then you can get new business, new horizon. Okay?
Thank you.
So don't close your mind. If you change the mind, you can make bigger your company, or maybe you don't want to make bigger, but make unique. Okay? Not only necessary to be big, rather than try to be more unique. Then your company become much happy, much more creative. Change your mindset.
Thank you.
To be clear. You can do it. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Professor. And well, it's come to the end of our evening today. This has been a big learning experience, you know, for me, for all of us. And I will keep my remarks to three. So one is, maybe we should change the name of the series from Dean Speaker Series to Dean's Engagement Series. thank you. This has been the most engaging presentation I have been to in many, many, many years. So thanks. Thank you for the entire team. So on behalf of all the students, staff, the ISB community, the community outside of ISB, I'd like to thank you very much for making this occasion, for engaging, you know, with all of us. And the third point I'd like to make is this is going to be very difficult for the next engagement speakers to follow. So on behalf of all of us, I'd like to extend a small token of our appreciation. Not just in these books, but in our memories. These will definitely go in both our libraries, the LRCs, in Hyderabad as well as in Mohali. So on behalf of everybody, once again, thank you so much. Thank you, Boy. You have
good question. Thank you very much. Good question. Thank you.